Tengo la suerte de presentar a un auténtico fenómeno de la batería, de las redes sociales, de trabajar con músicos y artistas de la talla de Michelle Williams, con Beyoncé, con Fifth Harmony, Andeya, y su nombre es Taylor Gordon, también conocida por The Pocket Queen. Taylor, welcome to Sevilla. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm fine. I'm so happy to have you here.
Thank you. I've been following you
in the webs and the media, social media.
Thank you.
You're a phenomenon on the social media, so to speak. I
mean. Yeah, it seems to have picked up ever since 2017. And it's gotten me a lot of work, a lot of exposure. And it's created a brand for myself, which I wish to enterprise. So it's turned me to a bit of a businesswoman ever since then.
That's fantastic. And how was the experience playing with Beyoncé? Where did it start? Because it had a connection with the video that you...
Yeah, actually that experience happened from videos that I was posting in college. There was a period before I had established my brand as the Pocket Queen in 2017, or reestablished it, that I was posting videos in college and I would do this series called Road to Chops, where I would pretty much learn different techniques and chops and licks that I would learn from all of my other drummer friends, and I would post videos of them teaching it to me, and then I would teach my audience. And this particular person, who ended up being Beyoncé's musical director, happened to be at Chick-fil-A at the same time that I was at Chick-fil-A, walked up to me, introduced himself as the MD for Beyoncé, which I was kind of skeptical. I was like, okay, like, you're the MD for Beyoncé. But surely, a year later, I'd never heard anything from him, but a year later, he calls me and says, hey, I have an audition for you for February. And I know the biggest events that happen in February in America are the Grammys and the Super Bowl. And by process of elimination, I found that it was the Super Bowl. So it just shows that results may not happen immediately. When you put up certain videos or certain content, sometimes it takes time, but you never know who's watching. You never know the effect it's gonna have on someone or who you're inspiring. So it just shows the power of social media and the power of content in today's world.
Mm-hmm. How's the experience of preparing a show like the Super Bowl one for with Beyoncé? I mean, how many rehearsals? How long does it take?
We rehearsed for a week. Yeah,
she was very picky about the camera angles.
She knew
exactly how things had to be done.
Absolutely, and that
you learned from that too.
That was very inspiring. Like, you know, the camera angle that I do for my videos online now, that was partially because I didn't have something to prop my camera on. I didn't have a camera stand. Mm-hmm. And B, I found that angle complimentary to me and the way that I look. So I somewhat took that technique from Beyoncé of like using certain angles and certain, because when you have cameras that come from downward, it creates somewhat of a superior like wow effect when you're looking up at something rather than looking down. So I thought about that with the angle of playing the drums. And I think that experience actually taught me that you can be very intentional about how you present yourself and how you want to be perceived. It's all in your control.
Mm-hmm. That's fantastic. And how long the rehearsals were?
The rehearsals were about 2 weeks. And in all honesty, it was 2 weeks, but we didn't know what we were wearing. We didn't know certain things until the very last minute. Like, even certain dance moves or certain choreography was added in. Is he gonna be in a shot? Like, do it.
Wait. Your hair was in the sound.
Oh, okay, I'm moving. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know it was hitting the... Do y'all want me to say all this over?
No.
I can say it again. But...
No, we'll go on as long as you want.
Okay, where was I?
We were talking about the rehearsals.
Yeah.
For about 2 weeks.
Okay, rehearsals were 2 weeks. But there were certain things that we didn't know until the very last minute. So no matter how much we prepared, there was still certain things, like Beyoncé was still trying on different outfits and different things, like no, until the last day before. And usually,
really?
You would think that would be like scary, but that sort of thing happens a lot in music. And it just shows you, no matter how much you rehearse, like live music is live music and a show is a show, and all you can do is prepare as best as you can.
We'll be right back. And I read you started with a Fisher-Price toy drum set, is that right?
A Fisher-Price toy drum set?
That's what I read somewhere.
It might have.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Your father got you that one.
Well.
And you would play along to your father's music, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Toto.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I'm not sure if it was Fisher-Price, though.
Internet knows more about us than
I was like, it could be. I was like, it could have been Fisher-Price. It was definitely a child set. Uh-huh. I will say that. Fisher-Price question. But my first big girl drum set was a Tama Swingstar, which is kind of amazing because I bought my first, I didn't buy it, I didn't have money. My dad bought my first pair of hi-hats, which were a pair of Paiste Alpha series. And it's so funny that now that I'm grown up in a professional that these are my companies, these are the people that came to me and endorsed me, like the people that I started with from a child.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
And how about from that drum set up to Berklee? You went to Berklee College.
Yeah.
How was that experience?
Oh man, it was very different for me in particular because I was blessed to receive a presidential scholarship to attend the school. Mm-hmm. And the thing about getting that scholarship is that people already know who you are before you get there because they hear like, oh, there's like these seven people that got like a full ride to attend the school, like who are they? Wow. And then it somewhat puts you at this expectation of people to like analyze your playing and see if you're really deserving of what you have achieved or what has been given to you. And so I entered the school with a different pressure than most people because I feel like most people are proving themselves from the bottom and building their way, but I came in at a place right here and I sort of felt that pressure of like trying to live up to everyone's expectations, which I somewhat got tired of. I was like, well, that's not who I am, you know?
No,
like you expect me to be this like chop filled spectacular, like know everything drummer because I received the full ride to go here. I don't live up to the expectation. It made me rebellious a little bit. And I kind of closed myself off from everybody and all of the student body from, what is it, auditions. I didn't audition for much. Yeah, and I think it was the most important process for me because I think it's where I really found what was important to me as a musician and why I love music, not what everybody else wants from me. I figured out what I want from me. And I went back to the place where I was playing that Fisher-Price drum kit. I was playing that Fisher-Price drum kit and I was playing along to the Doobie Brothers and I was playing along to Earth, Wind & Fire. And I remembered those feelings. And I was like, I want that to still feel the same way no matter what, no matter how old I get. I want to bring that sort of drumming. I want to take from those sort of players. And that's who I want to be. You know, I want to influence people to play for music and play for the pocket.
That's what comes next.
Mm-hmm.
Taylor Gordon, AKA the Pocket Queen.
The Pocket Queen. I'll tell you that story
too. Can you explain where that comes from? And what is the pocket? Here in Spain, we don't use that definition. So can you give us?
Well, I'm trying to stay consistent with my definitions because I've given the definition.
Everybody asks
you the
same
thing, I'm
sure.
Yeah, I've given the definition several times, and so people go to different places and find different definitions. They're gonna be like, "What are you talking about?" So, I define pocket as not necessarily having to do necessarily what you play, but the spaces in between what you play. It's the spaces in between the notes, and it
not play.
And yeah, and it sort of decides how the music feels. And pocket is supposed to be the defining factor of how people move, how people feel when they listen to music, how they dance, and how the music flows. Like, it's about analyzing that. Not what's being played, but how it feels in between. That's pocket.
All right. Yeah. You're the Pocket Queen.
Yes.
That's your approach for drumming. I read that you want to develop that particular voice.
Yes.
How do you do that?
Really, I found the most productive way to do that is listening.
Less is more?
Less is more. Listening is important. I do a lot of analyzing of my own playing. And I even analyze the reasons why I made certain musical decisions. Like, did I do that to like try and show off or try and fit something in, is that actually needed for the music? And I go back and I fix it. You know, I somewhat approach music or drumming like a producer, because I am a music producer. That's what I look at myself as. And so with that, I do a lot more listening than playing. I try to listen to the music first a lot and somewhat internalize it to the point where I can feel when certain things are coming and I can let it be natural. It's not something that I'm thinking too much about. Almost like this conversation that you and I are having. It's not like I'm necessarily thinking about what's coming next or what I'm going to say next. It's just flowing. And I think that's how music should work as well.
That's wonderful.
The other day I watched a video of you and you were singing, playing guitar, playing bass, playing piano, playing drums, filming, editing, video editing. I mean, you were doing everything. And you were doing really well. I mean, it sounded so groovy, beautiful, you're singing. So you do sing, you do play guitar. Can you tell us about that multi-instrumentalism you've been?
Yep, I sing, I play guitar, I play a little bit of bass, a little bit of keys. I love music. That is mainly what I do. I stopped doing that.
You're self-taught, or you got that at Berkeley?
I'm somewhat self-taught, a little bit. I took guitar lessons briefly because I wasn't getting to shred like the Van Halen songs, and I got upset and I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. And so I have the basics of guitar and bass, and I use that to make music. And YouTube honestly has a lot of lessons anyway for anything that you need. I've learned to play tons of songs just from watching YouTube videos, so all of the knowledge you need is accessible. Anywho, yes, I play those instruments. I more so, as I said before, I look at myself as a producer. For a brief period, was signed to a publishing deal with APG, Atlantic Records, as a music producer. And so that is, I think that also has a big effect on the way that I play and the way that I approach music as a drummer, because I'm not necessarily thinking of it as a drummer who's like really into the wood and all of the pieces. Like if you look at my setup, it's very simple, because I find that you don't necessarily need a lot to make a lot happen, you know?
And how about doing clinics and master classes and things like you're doing here at the Tantan Drum Fest? How do you approach yourself mentally, physically? I mean, what?
You know, I haven't done very many clinics. This is actually one of the first clinics that I've done.
How do you feel?
I feel good. I don't even know what to really expect. I'm taking it one day
nervous
as it goes.
Nervous or you're
relaxed? A little bit. It's kind of kicking in a little bit, but I'm trying with that sort of feeling to somewhat analyze my intentions. Again, like if I'm playing for the music, if I'm playing for that purpose solely, self doesn't matter. I think that somewhat nervousness is a selfish feeling if you analyze it, because you're very absorbed in your own self, you're self-conscious. Mm-hmm. So if I make it not about me, I'll be less nervous. So.
That's right. How about practicing? How long you practice and how often? If you practice now, or you do a lot of playing rather than practicing?
I do a lot more playing than practicing, and I'm not necessarily proud of that. I feel like I should practice way more, but I feel like listening and gigging gives me real life practice. It's like the real life, experiences.
Experience.
Yeah, it's the real life experiences that are practiced for the next experience and the next, you know, like I'm gonna do this clinic, I'm probably gonna do way more. And I'm start here, but it gives me a base level to learn for the next one and the next one, and it'll get better and better. And the best part is people can watch it. They can watch it get better, and that's the most like satisfying thing for people.
And what are you going to be presenting at the Tantan Drum Fest? What music are you going to be playing to?
I'm going to be doing a few of the covers that have made me popular, that people like a lot. I'm going to be playing the music of this amazing arranger, songwriter, artist, Nico Yalassi. He's from Ischia, Italy. He's back there. He's making me nervous a little bit. I will be playing his music, which is amazing. I feel like it showcases great musicality, and I feel like it complements my playing very well, like, because I feel like all the elements that are in it, and it's very groovy, groove-oriented, mm-hmm. musical. So
beautiful.
I'll be playing that, and I think that is it. I hope that's enough music. Yeah.
There is one thing that I want to talk about a little bit. It's the topic of the woman drummer, female drummers.
Yeah.
Thanks God, it's becoming less of a topic because mm-hmm. it's a reality. Mm-hmm. But how do you feel the man's world up until very little time ago mm-hmm. is not anymore?
It's less and less, which is good.
You're doing a big part on that too.
Oh, I'm glad. I don't know. I've never really wanted to categorize myself as a female drummer. You know, I've never really looked at
that category. You are a female extraordinary drummer.
Right, right. But I guess when I look at drumming, I never really look at gender. I always look at who is best for the composition, the job. And I think more so, that is always what should matter. Mm-hmm. I noticed though, this is my own like opinion and observations. Yeah, my own observations. That as women, we are more nurturing. And I notice a lot when it comes to women who play, we have more of a nurturing sense to the music. You find that with a woman who is playing, because that's a part of our nature, you know?
That's fantastic. How about Taylor Gordon, besides being a drummer? Mm-hmm. I mean, what do you do in your day-to-day life?
My day-to-day.
What do you like? What do you enjoy? You enjoy cooking?
Going
to the movies? Do you do any sports? Tell us about the person.
I can't omit the fact that I love food. I'm a foodie. Mm-hmm. I'm from New Orleans. I love seafood. I love bread. All of the things that are not really that great for you, but I love that. I love shopping, I love fashion. I'm obsessed with fashion. You know, I try to, if I look fresh today, thank you, you like it. I like fashion. I love movies. I love fashion because of the visual aspect that you can pair with music, sort of like food and wine.
Let me interrupt you on your videos. Your biggest smile, when you give a smile to the camera and the way you always look is fantastic. It's really.
Thank you so much. I do try to think about
attractive.
It.
It makes it more. And this person is giving me something from her, from the bottom of her heart.
Oh.
Big smile. I mean, like you go when you go. I love
is
it.
Is that what I do?
Yes, you do something like that quite often. And then you start playing. It's beautiful.
Well, yeah, I think I just really try to get to a place where I'm having fun with most of the things that I do or the things that I post. Here's the thing, I do at least, I think, 15 to 20 takes of these songs uh-huh. that I post. And I review, and I don't necessarily pick the one that I played the best. I pick the one that makes me laugh the most. I pick that one.
It's a great message.
And I post it. Like, I think because it created such a feeling that I think everyone can relate to. Everyone can relate to happiness and laughter. Not everybody can relate to skills and being all of that, but we can all relate to that emotion that we feel and want to feel. We want to feel happy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Any personal project on the music side now? I mean, any
yep.
things you're coming up with?
Yep, I'm working on a lot of original music. I'm going to push for putting out my first single at the top of 2020. Uh-huh. Which will be all produced by me, sung by me, playing all the instruments, and a music video. So I'm gonna give it a try. I gave production a good solid try in 2014, and I moved back to drumming because I found that I did not really like how that was going. So I decided I'm going to produce myself.
Wonderful.
So that's what's happening in 2020.
Looking forward to it. Is your first time here in Spain?
It is. I'm going to do some exploring today. She looks beautiful.
Sevilla.
I'm working on my pronunciation. I have to see what this beautiful place has to offer today. before I play tomorrow.
Would you give some advice to the young people or the upcoming drummers, no matter what age or gender?
It's my friend. What is your name?
Luis.
Thank you, Luis. No matter what age.
No, I mean, just a general advice about commitment or about the fun. There are so many things you transmit in your presentations and videos.
I know there's so many. I was like, there's so many things I could say.
Say it. Say them.
I would say to be intentional. I think that is the main thing I would say is with everything that you do and every choice that you make, have an intention behind it and know what you want to accomplish, because it has a better chance of happening if you are that, if you do have that intention. And you set that intention daily. And I think that is, to me, most important.
Sounds fantastic. Great advice. Anything else you want to mention?
Follow me on Patreon, patreon.com/thepocketqueen. If you want to learn more tips from me, you can subscribe for $10 a month, every month. You know, I haven't been that active yet, but I'm going back to it. What else? YouTube.com/thepocketqueen. Everything. Instagram.com/thepocketqueen. Facebook.com/thepocketqueen. Follow me. I love you. Hope you love me. See you soon.
Taylor Gordon, también conocida por The Pocket Queen.
Thank you.
Pleasure.